Howdy, folks. I'm Jim Nash, your Oakland County Water Resources Commissioner, and welcome to today's show of Water by the Quarter. My show is always trying to introduce the public to the new concepts, to all the things that are happening, protecting our water resources. There's a lot going on right now in Lansing and in Washington and locally here in Oakland County. We're going to continue our series of interviews virtually as during the COVID-19, but I'm bringing in guests that I think have real significance for our region and Oakland County. Today, I'm honored to have as a very special guest, Congresswoman Elissa Slotkin from Michigan's 8th Congressional District. That includes Ingham, Livingston, and north of the northern part of Oakland County. Her career in national service has included serving in the CIA, serving in national security positions in both the George W. Bush and Barack Obama administrations. And she's been very involved with policy, with national issues for a significant amount of time. Welcome, Congresswoman Slotkins. Glad to have you on here. It's an honor to have you on here. And anything you want to start out with?
Thank you, Jim. It's great to be here. Thank you for all you do to help preserve and protect Oakland County water. I've seen it up close and personal. We've done a bunch of events together. I'm coming to you from Holly, Michigan at my farm in Holly, and where I am one of the 25% of Michiganders that has our own well that gets her water from well water. I was thrilled to come on because I have spent an unbelievable amount of time focusing on water issues in my first term. Part of that comes from, frankly, having a very different experience in national security, as you said. I really think of environmental security as homeland security because it's about protecting our kids and our families and our way of life. You know, if you can't hand your child a glass of water without knowing whether they might get an early childhood cancer or a learning disability, that is a threat to your family. And if you can't fish the Huron River, because you know where you learned to fish from your father and your grandfather, that is a threat to your way of life. So we are more likely to have a problem with our water than we are to have, you know, be a victim of a terrorist attack or some other threat. So I've been really focused on this. One of the things I've spent most of my time on, frankly, is PFAS. And Michigan is really, unfortunately, a leader on trying to deal with the PFAS problem because we're identifying it more quickly and more efficiently than a lot of other states, and we're trying to do something about it. So of the 9 provisions I've turned into law as a freshman congresswoman, 6 have been on PFAS, including really important things like after 2021, we're going to have to test our water for PFAS along with a bunch of other family of chemicals. So that was a good one. And then stopping the use of the military's use of this PFAS firefighting foam by 2024. So those are ones that I'm pretty proud of. Obviously, with COVID, all of our lives have changed. We're all doing things differently. We're having our meetings over Zoom and dealing with our economy and the fallout on both public health and economics, but it's still important that we don't take our eye off the ball on the long-term problems. And water is one of those things. We just have to be vigilant about it. We're the Great Lakes State. We're the stewards of the Great Lakes. They are part of our heritage, our culture here in the state. So I'm thrilled to do anything I can to advocate for cleaner, more available water. So thanks for having me, Jim.
Oh, I appreciate that. And this is something that's been vital to me for a very long time before I was in this position here. You know, we are doing a lot right now. Just recently, within about a week or so, you passed the Moving Forward Act. You know, you want to kind of explain what that is in terms of infrastructure spending? And
sure. So here in Michigan, we know that we need once in a generation investment in our infrastructure. I mean, it's fix the damn roads, but it's all those other things that we need to do to invest in our infrastructure. And we just had 2 dams collapse or be damaged. And we saw what happened in Midland. I mean, we see the consequences of underinvestment in our infrastructure. So this is our big signature infrastructure bill. It's a $1.5 trillion package. So that's what I mean by once in a generation. It passed through the House of Representatives. We're hoping that the Senate takes it up sooner rather than later. The big things on water in this bill, it establishes a PFAS infrastructure grant program. So that means grants can be competed for to help affected communities deal with the capital costs and cleanup of their water systems. It invests $40 billion over 5 years in the Clean Water State Revolving Fund. So it addressed like a big backlog we have on state and local clean water infrastructure projects, probably in some of your communities. It invests $4.5 billion over 5 years to replace lead service lines, something that we've made a priority here in Michigan. We want to do that all over the country because we know what happens if you don't deal with your problem with lead. A bunch of other great things on infrastructure, from broadband to work on our roads and bridges and all those things. But it would have a direct impact on some of those water projects we know we need to get to here in Michigan.
Oh, we certainly do. You mentioned the PFAS. Oakland County's been fairly lucky. We haven't had a whole lot of impact from PFAS. You mentioned the Huron River. Bottom southwest corner of Oakland County is Kent Lake, and that and downstream, there's now fish advisories. You shouldn't eat anything. And that's really going to impact people. It's a significant industry. It's part of our recreation industry, and it's going to have an impact. The other thing I was going to mention was the lead service lines. We're starting those programs. The way the lead's the law is set up in Michigan, the ratepayers have to pay for it. And we're looking, because some of our communities have significant issues with affordability. So we're worried about that, and we're hoping the feds and the state is going to come help us with that. That's very, very important. Another bill that you've been co-sponsoring is my Congresswoman Brenda Lawrence's water bill. Can you kind of go into that just a little bit?
Sure. So some of these initiatives, you know, in many ways are overlapping, because we're trying, like, come, you know, one direction or another, we want to get something passed that affects our water. And so this is a bill, it's called the Water Act. In Congress, everything's an acronym. So water stands for something, the Water Affordability, Transparency, Equity, and Reliability Act. So it creates a dedicated $35 billion water infrastructure fund for improvements across the country. That'd be a lot for Michigan, because we know that a lot of our water infrastructure is old and outdated. It just is what you guys have to deal with. It also would probably create nearly 1 million jobs across the country, right? Because if you're going to be repairing water infrastructure, you got to pay people to do that. That's a big job creator. It also expands things like technical assistance to our small and rural communities. We know that it's hard to maintain water systems. You don't always have the expertise. Communities like mine, we just can use all the help we can get. Funds projects to deal with PFAS, upgrades household and wells and septic systems. So if we've got a problem with some of us who have those things, and then helps homeowners deal with this lead service line issue and helps them afford that. So lots of great things in that bill. Again, it overlaps, but that's just because we all care a lot about water in our state.
If you want to get anything done, you got to make sure you're getting it from every direction you can. You mentioned PFAS. There's some significant issues going on directly with that. And that was some legislation you put into the National Defense Authorization Act, I guess, twice now, right? So you want to kind of go into that and see what we're doing. Because again, PFAS, everybody is affected by that one way or another. Even if it's not directly, there's other things that are going on with it. Again, our thing in Oakland County isn't as much military bases, but it's a lot of the older unlined, landfills are taking that. I think that's where it came from in Kent Lake and downstream. So what is going on with that?
Yeah. So for the Pentagon's budget, I'm on the Armed Services Committee. And every single year, no matter what, the Pentagon's budget passes, you know, on a bipartisan basis. So that's a really great way to get things into the bill, because you know it's going to turn into law. So we did a bunch of provisions, like I said, last year that I'm really proud of. The ones this year that we got in were, first, like I said, holding the military to the highest standard, whether it be federal or state, which would be transformative. It is pushing them to clean up around bases that are currently open and closed, places like Glasgow, where it's really pushing them to do their cleanup. It's little things like you know, I went to Selfridge Air Force Base and the base commander told me, you know, I'm an Air National Guard base and I don't have access to all these environmental funds that the active duty troops have access to just because I'm National Guard and not active duty. And I said, well, we can fix that. And we fixed that. And we put a provision that said, nope, the Guard can have access to the same environmental remediation funds as active duty. And then the other one that's a really big deal for the state of Michigan in a very different way is we don't have enough research dollars for remediation, understanding alternatives to PFAS, especially things like firefighting foam. Michigan's really on the forefront. I represent Michigan State University. We just started a PFAS research institute at Michigan State. So we put some amendments in the Pentagon budget. The Pentagon really has to pay to have folks research some alternatives to this firefighting foam and how to clean it up.
Well, that's terrific. And so again, I know Selfridge has been a real issue because again, that's an air base. They're constantly training to, you know, on fire suppression, and that's something that's always happened. My understanding is now they're not using PFAS anymore. They're just using a kind of a foam for training, but they'll still use it for actual firefighting. Is that
what happened? So we actually, one of the laws that I got passed last year was that the military had to absolutely immediately stop using this PFAS firefighting foam just for exercises, right? We all know, like if you have a real fire, imagine on a ship, I mean, you know, you got to be able to put that out. Soldiers and airmen and naval officers, their lives are on the line and we don't have a good alternative. But for exercises, for just training, we said, no, you got to stop. And so they're not using any of that foam for any practice exercises now. They use an alternative. Now, if they were going into combat, if they were going into a real operation, then of course they'd still be able to use it until we have a good alternative.
Right. I think that's kind of how most fire departments are doing it too. They're still using it for the actual suppression, but they're not training with it. They're not using it because, you know, you don't actually use it that often when you're doing it, you know, in real life. Can you explain what the PFAS Action Act is?
Yeah. So like I said, there's a ton of legislation, mostly coming out of the Michigan delegation, almost always bipartisan, because this affects communities, whether you're a Democrat or Republican, it does not matter. And the PFAS Action Act was something that Representative Debbie Dingell really spearheaded. This is her baby. And it passed in the past year. And it's really important because it requires the EPA to establish drinking water standards for PFAS, which were badly, badly needed. And it prevents new products with PFAS from coming to the market. That's important. So we're not just throwing in more and more PFAS-laden stuff. And it designates PFAS as a hazardous substance under the Superfund cleanup program. So that means if we've got a problem, like in a place like Oscoda, we can access Superfund cleanup funds that previous to this, we just weren't able to access. So it actually moves towards cleanup rather than just diagnosing the problem. So it's a pretty big deal.
No, that's certainly right. And I'm sure you're familiar with what happened with the green ooze last year on 696 in Madison Heights. Those kind of things, we had a town hall with the EPA and Eagle was there, and a huge crowd of people who were completely thanking the EPA and Eagle for being there, for doing the cleanup, because they recognize that this has a huge impact. And one of the things they mentioned was that just in Southeast Michigan, there's 9,000 toxic sites, according to Eagle. That I had no idea that there were that many. This is the kind of thing, and unfortunately, for many years, we've seen the EPA budget cut, the Eagle, formerly the DEQ budget, has been cut over and over again. We're lacking the manpower to enforce this and the remedial ability to pay for this, because unfortunately, we need better polluter protection laws. I just wanted to stick that in there because it's something that people do significantly care about, totally nonpartisan. Everybody understands protecting our water. And this leads me into the next question is, I was in your town hall. I think it was the last one really I did before everything got shut down about the wells, septic systems, all those things that are going on in your part of the county, in the more rural areas. Again, my we deal with every community in the county, so rural, urban, we're everywhere. You want to kind of talk about the Test Your Water Act and you know what that involves?
Yes, and it's not Test Your Water, it's Test Your Well Water Act.
Test Your Well Water Act.
Because it's for those of us specifically who are on our private wells, the 25% of Michiganders. This is something that I co-sponsored with Representative Dan Kildee from the Flint area. He represents Flint to Saginaw. They've got a lot of private well owners up there as well. And it requires the EPA to set up a single website with information on finding certified groundwater testers. And then helping homeowners understand their test results, right? We know that as private well owners, we are responsible for testing our own water. And so we want to make sure that everyone who's in this situation, the one quarter of Michiganders, know how to test, how to get someone certified over to your place to look at it, what those results mean, how to interpret them, and then provide information on federal and state help in case you've got a contaminated well. If you've got a problem with your well, you know, that's a pretty big deal for a homeowner who's on a private well. So you've got to be connected with programs that can help you subsidize whatever you need to do to clean up that well or bring some clean water in. It's just something that I felt was close to my heart because we've just recently tested our water again. It's something we think about quite a bit. And I know that everyone who manages their own water wants to know that their water is safe.
That's certainly true. And in my office does not actually regulate wells. That's in Michigan, that's done by the health departments. Michigan, you know, I think we're the only state that doesn't have a statewide septic ordinance. The Eagle now estimates up to 20% of all septic systems in the state are failing. That has an immediate impact on nearby waterways. And we've had cases in Oakland County where significant numbers of people along lake shores have had to have sewers put in because their septics were failing. That can cost $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 per home. So we need to do more around that. The education is the biggest part. Most people who get wells, they don't really even know much about them and you know what the potential hazards are and how to make sure that they're safe. So this kind of thing is vitally important. For many, many people, even in Oakland County. You know, we're very heavily urban in the south part, but most of our rural areas, a lot of them are on private wells. My office operates a few systems for, smaller systems of wells, but people just don't really know. So the more we can do education, the better. And this is a very good start on that. The most important long-term issue facing the human race and including us is climate change. My office has been working, the two real directions we need to go on climate change are mitigation, getting off carbon sources, methane sources, fossil fuels, and remediation and resiliency. Because when we have these large storms, which are gonna be the biggest impact in this area of climate change, we need to build the infrastructure that's going to support that and not have flooding because these storms are only going to be getting bigger as time goes on. We have to come to grips with that. And I know that you're doing a lot. So kind of, can you go over some of the things you're doing around climate change?
Sure. I mean, first of all, my experience with this in my prior national security life, you know, because I'm not an environmentalist or a water person by training, was that I helped co-author the first study of how climate change would affect the military when I was at the Pentagon. And it was everything from increased risk of conflict in the Arctic because of competition with Russia as things melt, increased food insecurity, people competing for shrinking food supplies, an increase in the number of superstorms. You know, for the US military, we're called out if you have a superstorm Sandy, we're called out to help, guard and sometimes reserves to help out. So if you had two superstorms in one season, that would really stretch, you know, our abilities to support. Some of our bases, our naval bases at Norfolk would be underwater. And our firing ranges that we use for practice were just gonna be too hot, too many days of the year for live ammunition. So it would cost a lot of money to, adapt to all this climate change for the military. So that was my sort of original, you know, dipping of my toe in this water. And, you know, I guess when you come from a Pentagon background, you're a planner, right? You're constantly planning for worst case scenarios, for potential conflict, for potential attack. You're constantly thinking through that. And if there's even a 10% chance that climate change is going to do all the things we think and know it's going to do, we need to be taking preparation right now to mitigate it. I mean, serious preparation. And so we've done a few things. The one of the ones that I really like is the Clean Economy Act. I'm a sponsor of this, and it's basically, it moves us to a nationwide goal in the U.S. economy of net zero climate pollution by the year 2050. The good news is Michigan, like consumers' energy, is moving off of fossil fuels just by closing down old plants and putting more investment in natural gas. So these are things that I think Michiganders already sort of see in our sights, but we need to push forward on. And then, you know, listen, there's got to be international standards around climate. I mean, this was the Paris Climate Accord. This was the attempt to do that. We can't just do something here and then allow places like China or elsewhere to do whatever they want to do. But we have to accept that there are international standards and we're a part of this community. So there's a bunch of bills. The Climate Action Now Act is one of them that helps us, you know, say and subscribe in a legislative way to those international standards.
Well, this is what we need to be doing. You know, almost 4 years ago, well, 3 years ago now, I got solar panels at my house. So my house is totally, you know, there's so many things we can do. We're doing a project in Pontiac where we're adding a new process, only the fourth in the country, first in Michigan, where we're going to be able to pull methane out of the solid wastes and sewage. Instead of landfilling them, and we'll be able to eliminate all our fossil fuels to run the plant. We'll produce a grade A fertilizer that we can give away to local communities. We'll be saving millions of dollars in landfilling. There's so many things. The water, sewer, stormwater sector in America uses about 3.5 to 4% of all the energy in the country. If we can then turn use of energy into production of energy, we can contribute a dramatic amount of energy to the grid. There's a lot of potential. Anywhere there's flowing water, there's potential for power. Dams in natural areas, that affects the environment in ways that we don't like, and we're getting rid of dams nowadays. Within our systems, we can put in turbines to produce energy. We can produce energy from solids. There's a ton of different things that can be done. More we have for encouraging that, the better we are. You know, the 30% back on investing in renewable energy, that's one of the reasons I bought into it. And that's going away, but we need it back, and we'd love to have that back. So there's a lot of things that can be done around climate that I'm so happy that you're working on in these areas. Going forward, I guess I'm out of questions. Is there anything else you'd like to kind of really cover before we're done here?
No, I mean, I think, you know, the only thing we haven't talked about in a specific way, and we just shouldn't end the conversation on water without it, is the importance of protecting our lakes, our Great Lakes. And that is our job. I mean, there's lots of other states that border the Great Lakes, but none of them have as much reach into as many lakes as we do. And it's just really important that we invest in the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative. This is this huge plan to protect our Great Lakes from invasive species, from pollution. And, you know, for me, that's just kind of job number one when you're an elected leader, in making sure we update the SULACs. You know, we have to make sure that we're doing our part to be the first state in the country to always think about the lakes.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. Every drop of water that lands on us ends up in the Great Lakes. We're the only one that can say that. We're the only state. And we do have a massive impact on the lakes. My office works hard on that. We've gotten some of those grants. Counties surrounding us have gotten those grants. And it's done a tremendous amount of good. Those are the things that allow us to clean up these waters without hitting ratepayers so hard that they can't afford the water. And that's the balance we have to have. So again, I appreciate you coming on the show today. This has been very, very informative. I really appreciate it. We're doing tremendous work. I just can't tell you how much I appreciate you being in Washington doing that work. And I just look forward to seeing you on the trails doing all the things that we do. And I hope you have a good return to Washington and we get a lot of good things done the rest of this summer.
Thank you, Jim. And thanks for your work, your tireless work to protect our water. We need people like you with our most precious resource. So thanks for all that you do. Have a good one.
I appreciate it. And you too, Nell. That's it for my show this time. And I hope I'll see you guys again. Take care.